its breath till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who had come to the Father are restored. And the Church of Christ was born, then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me.
Shall not faint. By His blood and in His name, darkness, we were waiting without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt.
Darkness. all of you is more than enough for all of me, for every thirst and every need. You satisfy me with your love, and all I have in you is more than enough.
Oh Lord, let us realize that, God, that you are more than enough for us. In the struggles of the day, when we feel like we are at our backs against the wall, God, you are more than enough for our needs, for our love, for hope. God, you are the one who runneth over our cup. And so, God, I just pray that we can realize that. Lord, we just want today to be a day to lift your name on high and give you glory, God. And we just love you so much and thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey, good morning. Happy Independence Day, right? I had somebody say, oh, you're patriotic this morning. You're wearing your red, white, and blue. And I was like, yeah, I got red and white. And they said, no, I mean red and blue. And they said, well, your beard is the white. So there's that. Thanks, Denise. Thank you, Denise. Love your ministry of exhortation there. No, that's great, though. I did intentionally do this. Because I tell you what, as Christians, as the people of God, what an incredible privilege. And just as citizens of the United States of America, what an incredible privilege to be born and raised in this country, a country where we have freedoms. Testing. Oh, okay. All right. So I'll say this as well, that along with our freedoms, along with the freedoms we have to worship, which is an incredible gift and a blessing from God, there's a lot of brokenness in our nation too, right? I mean, never in my lifetime have we been so divided as a nation, and some of our cities are burning. There's so much social unrest in our country and in our cities. It's a crazy time to be alive, and there's a lot of hurt and there's a lot of brokenness, and people are crying out for hope and help. And of course, we as the church have the answer. Okay, the answer is never going to be found in the kingdoms of men. The answer is always going to be found in the kingdom of God, and that's what King Jesus came to bring us, is a new kind of kingdom where justice reigns and where peace and righteousness dwells. And we have a king who can make that happen. We have a king who has promised to make things right, to set things right, and to bring justice. And so just before we get into our children's message, I just thought it would be appropriate to take some time to pray for our nation. As we recognize both the incredible gift and blessings of our freedoms, but also the great struggle that we have for brokenness and sinfulness and justice issues that are going on in our country. So let's be praying for that. All right, let's pray. Lord, we are coming to you right now and so grateful for the privilege of being raised being able to live as citizens of the United States of America, and your hand of blessing that has been upon our nation. And yet, in the midst of that, there is so much brokenness and so much division and so much strife. And we recognize that it's the result of sin. When we as a people and we as a nation have turned our backs on you, we reap the consequences of that.
Okay, so we just take a few moments here for our children's message as we're going through the story of the Bible. Just a reminder, too, for those of you that have little ones, Amanda's going to be teaching the children's church, and we're going to head downstairs to have the children's church at the end of the singing here in just a few moments, right before the message, so don't forget that. But this is for our children today, and we're talking through the story of the Bible, and we were talking about the prophets. You know, a big chunk of the Old Testament is made up of the prophets. Over a third, between a third and a half of the entire Old Testament has to do with the prophets and the ministry of the prophets. And here's the question for you kids. Why did God send his prophets? Why did God send prophets to the nation of Israel and Judah? Connor? Okay, they were his messengers. And what was his message? What was the message that he gave his messengers to give to the people? Judgment is coming, to warn of judgment and to call his people to repentance, okay? So coming judgment and call his people to repentance. And how, by the way, how did God finally, but did Judah and Israel listen to the prophets? Anyone? Autumn's shaking her head. No, they did not. Good job, Autumn. Way to speak up there. No, they did not. So since they didn't listen to the prophets, they didn't repent, they didn't turn from their idolatry, they continued to worship other gods, turn their back on God, he eventually had to remove his hand of blessing like we were just talking about, and he had to bring his hand of judgment. This is going to happen in the United States too. This is already happening here in the United States. When we turn our backs on God, he can no longer give us the blessing, so he removes his hand of blessing and he brings his hands of judgment. And how did God finally bring judgment on Israel and Judah? Anybody remember? Talked about it a little bit last time. Connor? Right. He sent pagan nations. The Assyrians conquered Israel, the Babylonians conquered Judah, and they took them away captive. And this was foretold hundreds of years before, and the prophets kept saying, if you don't turn back to God, if you don't walk in his will and his way, there's going to be judgment. There's going to be consequences of that, okay? And sure enough, they failed to repent, and so God sent these pagan nations to be his hand of judgment in their life. Let me ask you a question. Is God done with his people when he finally brings judgment in their life, when he finally allows, when he punishes them? Is he done with his people? Think about this for a second. Think about your parents. Is your relationship over with your parents when they bring punishment into your life, when they bring discipline in your life? Does that mean they no longer want to be your parents? No. But why do you think that your parents punish you or discipline you? Anyone? What do you got, Lizzie? Because they love you, and they want what? What do they want? Connor? They want you to obey. Yeah, they want you to obey. They love you. They want you to obey, but they want a relationship with you. They want to live in. They want you to have unity as a family. You want to be on good terms. They don't want you every time you walk in the house to not look at them and go straight to your room and slam the door and not ever speak to them, and you just coexist in the same house. That's not family. That's not a relationship. No, they want a relationship with you. And so your parents, when you're walking away and rebelling against their authority in your life, and they bring discipline in your life, it's not just to get back at you and to punish you or to be angry with you and to, you know, punish you for disobeying them. It's to restore you back to right relationship, to make the relationship right, to remove the sin that's broken the relationship. Because remember, sin always what? Separates. Sin always separates. It always breaks relationship, first with God and then with one another. And our sin does that in our lives and our relationships. So, even while the southern kingdom of Judah had been conquered and carried away captive into Babylon, God even raised up prophets in Babylon during the time of their exile to remind them of God's promises. Does anybody remember one of the prophets that God raised up in Babylon to speak God's truth to his people, even while they were being punished, even while they were being judged, even while they were in exile? Lizzie? Daniel, yes. Hopefully you guys remember that, because it wasn't that long ago that we as a church went through the book of Daniel, right? And another one was Ezekiel. They both prophesied during this time of exile. And what were some of God's promises to his people? Do you remember that Daniel and Ezekiel reminded them of while they were in exile? What were some of the promises that he reminded them of? Connor's on a roll this morning. Anybody want to? Because he's going to get the gold star for today. All right, what do you got? What are some of the promises? What are some of the promises, Connor? Okay, 70 years, they're coming. This exile is not forever. God's not done with them. What a great promise that would be, because they all thought he was. Oh, no, Israel's done. Jerusalem's destroyed. The temple's destroyed. The walls broken down. Our kings have been killed. We've been carried off into exile. We are over. God's done with us. He's set us aside, and God said, no, my promises that I made to your ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, and David, I'm gonna make good on them. I'm gonna fulfill them, right? So 70 years you're gonna be restored. And not only that, but I'm gonna restore not just Israel and Jerusalem and the temple, but but I'm going to raise up for you a new king, a good king, a righteous king of the line of David, of the house and lineage of David. And he's going to shepherd you toward me, not away from me like these wicked kings have done for so many years. And he's going to establish a new covenant with me and with you as my people. And he's going to, and he's going to help this new covenant by giving you a new heart, and he's going to put his spirit in you so that you'll be able to obey God's commands finally, for once be able to obey God's commands from the heart. So these are hopeful messages. These are good messages that God was gracious to them even while they were in Babylon. So Daniel was just a teenager when he was taken captive to Babylon, but God was with him. And just like he did with Joseph so many years before in the kingdom of Egypt, he raised him up to a very powerful position as an advisor to King, what was the king of Babylon's name? Lizzie? Nebuchadnezzar, right, King Nebuchadnezzar. And God did this by giving the king a very disturbing dream in which he revealed his plan for all of human history, for the kingdoms of men. But Nebuchadnezzar had no idea what it meant, but he knew it was important. And so he called all of his wise men, all of his counselors, all of his advisors in to tell him what it meant. But he gave a little caveat. He says, in order for me to be sure that you aren't just making something up, what did he ask his wise men to do? Not just tell them what the dream meant, but also to tell them what? What the dream was. And they're like, no king has ever asked his wise men to do this. You tell us the dream and tell you what it means. And he said, no. We've done that. We've played that game. No. I want you to tell me what the dream was, so then I know that you have the wisdom to interpret it. And they're like, we can't. And so he says, just okay, so I'm going to kill all my wise men. You obviously aren't wise enough to advise me, so I'm going to kill you all. So they come pounding on Daniel's door to kill him. And he says, what's going on? He said, the king's killing all the wise men because they couldn't tell him his dream. He said, can you just give me a little time? I'm going to talk to the one who gave him the dream. And so he went and asked his friends Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego to do what? So that God could tell them the dream. What'd they do? Yes, good job. He prayed. They prayed. She beat you to it, Connor. They prayed. They said, "Oh God, oh you alone are the giver of dreams. You alone know the future. You alone can do this." And God revealed to Daniel the interpretation of the dream. And so he went back to the king. He said, look, stop killing all the wise men. Listen, he says, there is no wise man. There is no enchanter or magician or advisor who can unlock these mysteries and tell the king what he dreamed and what it meant. But there is a God in heaven who knows all things. And he has given you this dream to let you know what's going to happen in the future. And then he told him his dream. Remember this dream? In his dream, the king saw this massive statue with a head of gold and chest and arms of silver and belly and thighs of bronze and legs of iron and a feet of mixture of iron and clay. And then this big rock cut out by invisible hands smashes the statue to bits, and the wind blows the dust of the statue away and it's completely gone. And in its place, the rock becomes a huge mountain that fills all the earth. And Nebuchadnezzar goes, that's it. That was my dream. What does it mean? And so Daniel said, O king, this is what the God of heaven is telling you that your dream means. The God of heaven has ordained the kingdoms of men. The head of gold and the chest of silver and the belly and thighs of bronze, all of these are kingdoms. And you and your kingdom are the head of gold. Then there's another kingdom coming after you that's inferior to yours. And then that kingdom will be conquered by a third kingdom, the bronze kingdom, followed by a fourth kingdom that's as strong as iron, and just as iron breaks all the other metals, so this kingdom will break and smash the previous kingdoms. But the feet and iron of clay will be a different kind of kingdom that comes after, a federation of kingdoms, some strong and some weak, but eventually it won't hold together any more than iron and clay can hold together. And at that time of those kingdoms, that confederation of kings, in those days of those last kingdoms, King Jesus will return. And he will crush all the kingdoms of men once and for all, establishing his eternal kingdom that will never be destroyed. And so this message was given by God through Daniel. And the main message of the whole book of Daniel, if you can remember this, is that the Most High God is sovereign over the kingdoms of men. That means he's in control of them all. and he gives them to whomever he chooses. That God is in control even of human history, and one day he's going to establish his own kingdom, and human history will be done, and then true king will reign forever in a kingdom of righteousness and glory. What a great promise that is, right? And King Nebuchadnezzar was blown away, and he fell down on his face before Daniel, declaring, "Your God is truly the God of all gods and the King of all kings and the revealer of all mysteries." And he worshiped God. Now, it was going to take a lot more for King Nebuchadnezzar to really bow his knee and surrender his heart to God, the creator of the universe, but he eventually gets there. God breaks his pride. Even a pagan king. The Bible tells us this, that the heart of the king is in the hand of the Lord, and he turns it however he wills. That God is more powerful and more stronger and more in control than all the kings of men. So this gives us hope. Even when life around us is going badly, even when the people of God were captive in a pagan nation, and sometimes it can feel like that for us today, right? We're living in a pagan nation where good is called evil and evil is called good. It's no longer a righteous nation. It's no longer a nation that recognizes God and worships him alone and follows him alone and submits to his will. So we can take hope that the God of the universe one day is going to rule over the kingdoms of men, and that he's in control right now, and one day he's going to establish his eternal kingdom. And that gives us hope. But that also gives us a job to do, because the people of God don't just sit back and wait for Christ to return. They are part of the process. They are part of what God is doing in the world to further his kingdom and ultimately to establish his kingdom. We're going to be talking about that a little more in the message a little bit later. Good listening. The prophets played such an important role in the work of God in the world. So take hope, take heart. God is in control. All right, let's keep worshiping today.
Above the waves, when oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, you are mine. Abounds in deepest waters, your sovereign hand will be my guide. Feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you never fail, and you won't start. Above the waves, when oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, you are mine. Trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, that my faith would be made stronger. of my Savior. Spirit, lead me when my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me when my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me. Take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. My faith would be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. That I breathe, I am I am yours forever. All of me surrenders. I am absolutely in love. And Jesus, you have me completely. Every breath that I breathe, I am absolutely in love. And Jesus, I am yours forever. All of me surrenders. I am absolutely in love with
you. Yes, Lord, we just ask that you would fill our hearts with your love, Lord, that you would make today just be a day where we just feel your overwhelming presence here. And God, just help us to be able to devote ourselves into digging into this message, Lord, and just be able to soak this up from what Nathan says. Lord, I pray that you would fill Nathan with your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray that you would give him the words to communicate with us to what you want us to hear today. And God, give us ears to hear and hearts that can just receive it. Lord, we love you and we just thank you for just all the blessings that you've given us, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen.
Okay, so the message of surrender that we were just singing, the song of surrender, and yeah, those of you that are headed down to Children's Church, you can do so at this time. But that's the heart of the message that Jesus calls us to. He is the King. There's only one true King, and that is King Jesus. And he calls for our undivided allegiance. He's looking for our undivided hearts. He wants total allegiance, total obedience. He wants us to worship him alone. There is no other God but him. And so any other worship, any other devotion of our lives and our affection of our lives is ultimately idolatry. And so Jesus in Matthew chapter 10, and that's where we are today. We're continuing our discussion in Matthew chapter 10. Remember this, Matthew's gospel has one purpose, one main purpose, and that is to affirm that Jesus is King. Okay? We got 28 chapters, and we're only in chapter 10, but every little section of Scripture that we go through, keep that main theme at the center of your heart and mind as we go through this and as we think about this, okay? It's affirming that Jesus is the true King. And Matthew's desire in writing this, actually the Holy Spirit's desire in having Matthew, empowering Matthew, inspiring Matthew to write this, is that there be no question in the heart and soul of a man or a woman, but that Jesus Christ is the one and only true King, okay? And Matthew knows that people find other kings to serve, that they are unwilling to submit to the kingship and lordship of Jesus, to the sovereignty of Jesus in their life. They're unwilling to submit themselves, and that's why singing such a song like we just sang, "You have me completely. All I am and all I have is yours." This is what King Jesus is looking for from his subjects, is the bowed knee, the submitted heart, the surrendered life, okay, the obedient life. But this is the battle, as you know. It's so hard for us, right? Because there's so many other things that are vying for our attention, for our affection, for our worship in this world. And we give our hearts away to so many different things, right? And so this is what is so natural to us in our rebellion against God, our temptation to rule our own lives, to put ourselves on the throne of our own lives, is not to submit to the lordship of Jesus, to not submit ourselves to his total and sovereign rule. And so there's this battle, this tension, and that's the message of Matthew. And we have to constantly be coming back to that, because this is where the battle rages in our own hearts, in our own lives, okay? And so the passage of Scripture that we're discussing today is the second half of Matthew chapter 10. We're starting in verse 24 today. And let me just say this. I think I say this quite often, but this is really and truly a reality that Matthew chapter 10, the second half of Matthew chapter 10, is probably the most definitive and significant teaching of Jesus on the subject of discipleship. Now, the Sermon on the Mount was so vital to giving his new kingdom values and to shaping his people to being people after his heart, and that was really key. But specifically, the definitive significant teaching of Jesus on the subject of discipleship is right here in the second half of Matthew chapter 10. And in this passage, he teaches his disciples the goal of discipleship, which is ultimately to be like him, okay, Christ-likeness. He teaches them the goal of discipleship, what is to characterize his disciples as they go out on mission for him, and what the cost of discipleship is, and then he describes what it involves. We're going to be talking about the cost of discipleship a little bit more next week, but we're just going to be talking about some characteristics that Jesus says define those who are fully surrendered to him and are obedient to go out on mission for him. So we're going to be talking today about the characteristics of his missionary disciples, okay? So this is a very important passage of Scripture that we're going to look at today. We're only going to look at a few verses, like five, six verses, 24 through 31. And as Jesus' disciples here in the 21st century, we better sit up and take note, pay attention, because Jesus has a lot of important things to say about this matter of discipleship, which we are and we've been called to, okay? And so since discipleship was such a major, major focus of Jesus' teaching and ministry, obviously we believe that it should be the major focus of this church today, of our church, okay? And it is. You've seen our mission statement. We say this often, right? We exist to glorify God by making disciples through gospel, community, mission, right? We exist to make disciples through gospel, community, mission, okay? And so we're going to be talking a little bit about that today because we believe that the church has as its primary mission to make disciples. Jesus commanded this. Remember the Great Commission, Matthew 28? We're going to get there eventually. Go, therefore, and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, teaching them to obey everything that I've commanded you. Go and make disciples. That's Jesus' commission to his disciples. Go and make disciples. That's why we feel like God's called us to go and tell the good news of the gospel, to go and make disciples through gospel proclamation, through inviting people into healthy biblical spiritual community, and then going out on mission, right? So go and make disciples. That's the Great Commission. And here in chapter 10, this is exactly what Jesus is doing. He's modeling what it means to make disciples. So here, Jesus, we kind of catch Jesus in the middle of actually making disciples. He's training up his disciples who will then go, when he leaves, they will go and make disciples as well. And the cycle continues. The word disciple, by the way, is the Greek word mathetes, and it means, does anybody know what disciple means? What does it mean? Very close, follower. It's a little more specific than that. It's not just a follower. It's a student or learner or pupil. Mathetes, student, learner, pupil, okay? And so Jesus is called, at least at this point, he's called this group of 12, and he's teaching, building them to maturity in order to send them out to reproduce and advance the kingdom. And that's the same process that he's called us as his disciples in the 21st century to be engaged in, this process of making disciples. We first sit under Jesus' teaching and learn of him, and then we go out and teach others to learn of him too. And by the way, making disciples is more than just leading people to Jesus Christ, more than just getting them to believe in Jesus. See, that's not the end of the commission, that's just the beginning, okay? Gospel proclamation so that they will not only come to place their faith and trust, repent and believe in Jesus, but then commit to surrender and obey everything that he's commanded. So the goal in terms of like Paul, what Paul told the Ephesians in Ephesians chapter 4 is to equip his people for works of service so that the body of Christ may be built up until we all reach unity in the faith and the knowledge of the Son of God and become mature. That's the goal, spiritual maturity. So we can be attaining to the whole measure of the fullness of Christ. So that's the perspective of a disciple maker, equipping believers for works of service, to build up into unity and the knowledge and become mature attaining the whole measure of the fullness of Jesus Christ. So we're to reproduce mature disciples who in turn can reproduce themselves in others. And so this is what Jesus asks and desires of his disciples. This is the commission. This is what Jesus commands his disciples to do. Those who are willing to learn of him and to obey everything he commanded his disciples to be and to do. And that's really what it means to be a Christian, a true believer. See, when you become a Christian, you are in effect saying, not only do I believe in Jesus, but I choose to be a learner of the Lord Jesus Christ and to obey everything he's commanded me to do. So true conversion actually results in affirming his lordship, of bowing the knee to him and surrendering and submitting to him as my teacher, and that I'm his student or his pupil. And I'm going to learn from him and grow to maturity under his leadership and lordship in my life. And I'm going to submit to obey whatever he's asked me to do. So here we are in Matthew chapter 10, starting in, well, before we actually jump into verse 24, remember this is where we've come from. The first verse, he names all of his 12 disciples. And then 5 through 15, he instructed them, here's what I want you to do when you go out on mission. So he trained them what it's going to look like. And here's how to go out on mission. He gave them clear instructions on how to carry out the mission. Then in verses 16 to 23 that we talked about last week, he warned them, now here's what's going to happen when you go out on mission. You're going out as sheep among wolves, and there's going to be opposition, and it's going to get ugly, and they're going to be beaten, and all of that. And having warned them about what will happen, here he begins to talk to them in verses 23 through the end of the chapter, verse 42 that we're not going to get to today. He basically says, now, are you willing to pay that price? Here's what mission looks like. Here's what I want you to do. Here's how they're going to respond to you when you do go out on mission for me. Are you still willing? Are you willing to pay the price? Because it's going to cost you something. And that's where we are today. And that's why we need total surrender, like we were just talking about, just like we were just singing about. We need total surrender, or it's not going to happen. Many of us are going to determine that the cost is too great, the price is too high. We'd rather be comfortable and safe and happy and all of that. Now, let's look at verse 24. Jesus says, a disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It's enough for the disciple to be like his teacher and the servant like his master. And if they've called the master of the house Beelzebul, how much more will they malign those of his household? Who's the master of the house? Jesus, King Jesus. He's the Lord. He's the head of the household. He's the head of the kingdom. He's the king. And if they call the king of the kingdom, the righteous kingdom of God, Beelzebul, which is basically a name for Satan, if they call him Satan, the head of the house of demons, how much more are they going to malign those of his household? Okay, so here's the deal. It's enough. A disciple is not above his teacher, nor a servant above his master. It's enough for the disciple to be like his teacher and the servant like his master. That's the basic message of this entire passage, okay? Jesus has told them that he's sending them out as sheep among wolves, that they're going to be beaten in the synagogues, arrested, dragged before the civil authorities, that even members of their own household will want to see them dead and will betray them, and they'll be hated by everyone, and they'll be persecuted from town to town. Listen, that's a tough assignment. That's a tough calling. That's what mission's going to entail for you, my disciples. This is why he says, look, you can't be my disciples if you're not willing to deny yourself, take up your cross, and follow me. It's going to cost. That's a tough assignment. And it's going to require steadfast endurance if we're going to be able to take up the cross and follow him and do what he's asked us to do. And so now Jesus is telling his disciples that the ultimate goal of a disciple is ultimately to be like Jesus, Christ-likeness. This is the first characteristic of a follower of Jesus, of one who says yes to carrying on the ministry and message and mission of Jesus. The ultimate goal of discipleship is to be like his master. We're to be like our teacher. And we're to be like our master and our Lord and our King. That is the commitment of a disciple. We're called to be like him, to share his values and his commitments and his character and his priorities, and to be completely surrendered to his will and to do what he does and his purposes and his kingdom. See, we're to be like him. That's the focus and goal of a disciple, to be like our master, our teacher. So the bottom line is this. Discipleship is a process by which you become more and more like Jesus and less like your old sinful self, right? And the more you become like him and the more you put off crippled sinful habits of the past, of the flesh, and the more you put on the fruits of the Spirit, the more the world's going to treat you like they treated him. The more you become like him, the more they're going to treat you like him. So you should expect the same treatment that Jesus got, right? And by the way, how did they treat Jesus? Did they love him? Did they embrace him? Did they say, you're the greatest teacher ever? You've had people tell you this, right? Jesus was such a good teacher. He was such a good man. If he was such a good teacher and such a good man, why did they kill him? Why did they hate him? Why did they try to push him off a cliff? Why did they try to stone him? Why did they end up crucifying him? And, I mean, if he was such a good person and did such good things, and he did, by the way, he was good and he did good, but they hated him because he called them out on their sin. And so, why do Christians get surprised when doing what Jesus did and living how Jesus lived and saying what Jesus said, that we get some pushback from the world that killed him? Why does that surprise us? We continue to be surprised. We think if we're just good people and we're just really, really, really nice and we're just really, really, really kind and we give gas vouchers to people and we give them food and we care for their needs and we pay their electric bills and we just love them in Jesus' name and we go out and just nice and share the love all over Maquoketa, that everybody's just going to love us like they did Jesus, right? It's not what Jesus said. Jesus said, you're going to be hated. You're going to be persecuted. You're going to be arrested. You're going to even be betrayed by your own family. So what makes us think that we're going to be treated better than the world treated him? The reality is that there are a lot of Christians that are wanting better treatment, so they accommodate the world to keep from ruffling the feathers of the world, to keep from offending the world, so that we can play nice and get along, right? And that's a dangerous game to play as the followers of Jesus. See, Jesus is the creator of heaven and earth, the master of the kingdom of heaven. He came to earth specifically to call people to bow the knee to his lordship and to worship him as the only true Lord and King of the universe. But instead, what did they do? We don't want you telling us what to do. You're not the boss of me. You're not the Lord of my life. I'm the Lord of my life. I want to do what I want to do. I don't want to have to submit to and serve you. Submission feels like a bad word to us. Even surrender feels like a bad word. Too many of us have been watching WWE, and we go, that surrender, submission is not a good thing. It's not good. Or we think throwing the white flag, that means we're losers. We lost. But when we submit to the lordship of King Jesus, that means we're his good subjects in his eternal, glorious kingdom of righteousness and peace and holiness and justice. And we get to actually rule and reign with him. Submitting to King Jesus is not oppressive or onerous. But we share in his glory. We share in his rule and reign in his kingdom. And so instead of bowing the knee, the people of this world rejected him as their savior and as their Lord and master. And instead, they shockingly, perversely called him Satan, right? They called him Beelzebul or Satan. The instead of the King of Kings, they called him the King of the Demons. I mean, how perverse and how twisted is that? And so if they called the greatest man, the very embodiment of the goodness, glory, and righteousness and holiness of God himself as he lived and walked on this earth, if they called him the Prince of Demons, how do you think they're going to treat you when you carry on his ministry and his mission and his message? Jesus said, look, if they did that to me, how much more are they going to malign you and persecute you and falsely accuse you? So, if you hear any so-called follower of Jesus promising that if you're just a good person and a nice person and you just love everybody, then the world's going to love you and they're going to like you and they're going to welcome you with open arms and you're going to be exempt from any suffering and any persecution in this world. Not only that, but the world's just going to knock themselves out to bless you and to give you stuff. They're offering a false hope. In fact, they're teaching the exact opposite of what Jesus taught. So Christians who've never experienced persecution in this life probably haven't been bold enough in their witness. How's that, right? If you've never experienced any pushback, if nobody's ever going, what are you talking about? You're crazy. Are you a Jesus freak? If you've never had anybody accuse you of being a Jesus freak, you're probably not doing it right. Okay? You haven't been bold enough in your witness. Again, that doesn't mean that we're going out trying to pick a fight. We're trying to start something with people. A bunch of pagans. You need to hear the truth. Turn or burn. Stand on the street corner with a bullhorn and a placard telling them they're all going to hell. That's not what we're talking about. Okay? We're not trying to make enemies or pick a fight. But we don't equivocate on the truth. We just do what Jesus did. And if we think that if we just do what Jesus did that everybody's going to like us, he said, that's not going to happen. They're going to hate you. They're going to arrest you. They're going to beat you. They're going to kill you. They're going to want you dead like they wanted me dead. So the first characteristic of a disciple of Jesus Christ is Christ-likeness. We need to be like Jesus. But just remember this, that the more and more we are like Jesus, the less and less the world's going to like you. The more you're like Jesus, the less the world will like you. And that's why the second characteristic of a faithful, obedient, mature missionary disciple is courage. Courage is needed. What's one of the things that Jesus said to his disciples most often? What was one of the messages that he spoke, one of the set of words that he spoke to his disciples most often? Take heart. Take courage. Don't be afraid. Or fear not, right? That was the one. Fear not. Fear not. Fear not. Over and over and over again. Why would Jesus say that so much? Why did Jesus have to say that so much to his disciples? Because they were afraid. They were terrified. So just get this, right? Jesus just told them just a couple verses ago. This is basically in all the same sentence. I wish we could do it all as in one breath as Jesus did, but we're going to have to break it down. But Jesus just got through telling them, I'm sending you out as sheep among wolves. Sheep among wolves. We already talked about how the sheep fare among the wolves. How do they do? They get ravaged. They get slaughtered. They become dinner, right? And so these guys are terrified. Sheep among wolves. And then he said, if they didn't quite get the analogy, he said, you're going to be beaten, you're going to be arrested, you're going to be killed, you're going to be hated. So they're terrified, right? And so Jesus has to constantly circle back and say, but don't be afraid. Fear not. Fear not. Fear not. In fact, here in just these next five verses that we're looking at today, Jesus says it three times. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. Let's look at the first one here in verse 26 and 27. Don't fear persecution. Instead, boldly speak the truth. Yeah, easy for you to say, Jesus, right? He says, so do not be afraid of them. Who's them? The world? The wolves that he was just talking about, right? They're persecutors, the people that hate them. Don't be afraid of them. But they hate me. Don't be afraid of them. But they're going to arrest me. Don't be afraid. They're going to kill me, beat me. Don't be afraid of them. Proverbs 29 tells us that the fear of man will prove to us to be a snare. If we live in constant fear and gauge our life and our attitudes and our beliefs and behaviors by what men think of us, what people think of us, and we live in fear of what others will think and what others will do, and so we amend our beliefs and behaviors and attitudes and actions accordingly, it will be a snare to us. Because the fear of man chokes out effective disciples, effective witness. The fear of man chokes it out. The seeds sown in the thorny ground, and the weeds grew up amongst the wheat and choked out the life of the wheat because they were so concerned about the cares of this world. And part of that concern for us today is wanting to be liked and accepted and loved by the world, right? And if that becomes your goal and your aim to love the world, to fear man rather than God, that fear of man is going to choke out your witness. I know that we want people to like us, and we don't want to offend anyone, and we don't want to cause a problem. We don't want to make anybody feel uncomfortable. And boy, it's hard to do in these days, right? We don't want cancel culture to cancel us, right? And boy, you have to tiptoe around not to offend anybody today because people get offended by everything. We certainly don't want to be persecuted, so we go soft on the truth. We don't want to ruffle any feathers. We don't want to step on any toes. We don't want to offend anybody. We're afraid to confront the culture that Jesus sent us into the world to confront with his truth. But Jesus tells disciples, listen, you're going to be hated, you're going to be beaten, you're going to be arrested, you're going to be killed, but don't be afraid. Instead, you know, instead of fear, I want you to be courageous, be bold and courageous. As he was telling Joshua to go in and conquer the land, I said, well, these people are giants, and they have walled cities, and who are we? We're not really trained warriors, and we're like grasshoppers in their eyes. And God said to Joshua, be strong and courageous. Do not fear, be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. Be strong and courageous. And his message for us, his disciples in these days, is the same. Be strong. Be courageous. Don't be afraid. I am with you even till the end of the age, he tells his disciples. I'm going to give you the power. I'm going to give you even the spirit in you is even going to give you the words to say when I give you the opportunity to speak in front of them. So why shouldn't his disciples be afraid of the people who hate them? Here Jesus says, for there is nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the rooftop. So we shouldn't be afraid because the truth will one day be revealed. Nothing will remain hidden forever. What did Jesus mean by this when he said, there's nothing concealed that will not be disclosed or hidden that will not be made known? He's basically saying, someday I'm going to peel back the veil. I'm going to peel back the veil, and the sins that have been committed in secret will be revealed and judged accordingly, and everything will be made right. The just judge of the earth will return to reward the righteous, punish the wicked. He will sort it out and set it right. He'll separate the sheep from the goats, the wheat from the weeds, the believers from the unbelievers, the just from the unjust, and everybody will get justice. That should encourage you. So don't be afraid. You're like, well, what if something happens? What if they do something and justice isn't done? There's so much injustice in the world. God says, I got it. I am the just judge of all the earth, and you can trust and you can count on that I will surely do what is right. So don't be afraid. You do what I've called you to do. You be faithful in your bold proclamation of the truth, and I'll sort it all out at the end. I will ensure that justice is done. So don't be afraid. He says, I know that that's not the way that things are right now. Seems like the wicked, the bad guys are winning and the good guys are losing. The wicked are prospering. They're getting away with murder. Good is called evil. Evil is called good. And the more Christians take a stand for what is true and right, the more that they're hated, the more that they're persecuted. But Jesus says, don't forget. I'm the just judge. I'm keeping score. I'm taking account. By the way, vengeance is not ours. It's not. We're not the agents of justice in the world, even though we so want to be, right? We want to be justice warriors to set things right. But that's not our job. Jesus said, do not repay evil for evil. Vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. You faithfully proclaim my truth. You go out and carry out the mission and message of Jesus, and then I'll make sure to sort it all out at the end and that justice will be done. Someday, all this injustice that seems to be going unaddressed in the world today, it's all going to change. The truth is going to be made known, and I'm going to set things right. If Jesus' disciples are promised only a life of suffering and persecution, that would be a little daunting, right? If he just stopped at, hey, I'm sending you out as sheep among wolves, you're going to be beaten and arrested and hated and killed, go at it, go for it. But he didn't stop there. I mean, that would be a little intimidating. We'd be like, man. But he said, no, don't be afraid. Don't be afraid. What is hidden will be made known. What is concealed will be disclosed, will be revealed. See, we might tend to lose heart, to abandon the commitment to follow him, abandon our commitment to be on mission for him in the world. But Jesus said the future holds hope for those who patiently endure. So that should encourage us. The future holds hope for those who patiently endure. Judgment day is coming when God will eternally reward his people for their faithful endurance of suffering and persecution in this life. And he's promised he will punish the wicked forever, and the injustices of the world will be made right. So instead of being afraid of what's going to happen in the future, we know what's going to happen in the future. And so we can be bold in confronting this evil society with the truth of the gospel, with the truth of God, and trust that God will reward us for it all in eternity. Paul said it this way in 2 Corinthians 5. He says, we are always of good courage. We are always of good courage. We know that while we're at home in these bodies, we're away from the Lord, for we walk by faith and not by sight. Yes, we are of good courage. He says it again, good courage. we'd rather be away from this body than at home with the Lord. He said, we're in a battle. I mean, he went from town to town getting stoned and beat, imprisoned, ran out of town by riots and mobs. So he said, truth be told, it'd be much better for me to be with the Lord in heaven. We long to be away from this body and at home with the Lord. So, but whether we are at home or away, we make it our aim to please him. That's the goal, to please Jesus, to be like him, to follow him, to obey him. Why? Because we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ so that each one may receive what is due for what he's done in the body, whether good or evil. Therefore, knowing the fear of the Lord, the fear of men? No, the fear of the Lord. Knowing the fear of the Lord, we persuade others. We get it backwards, right? We're afraid of men. We're more afraid of men than God sometimes, so we kowtow to men because we're afraid of what they're going to do to us. He says, no, knowing the fear of the Almighty God, I boldly persuade men. I boldly, courageously persuade men. And then just right in the chapter before that was 2 Corinthians 5. In chapter 4, he said, therefore we do not lose heart. Easy to do in these days, right? We do not lose heart. Though outwardly we're wasting away, yet inwardly we're being renewed day by day. And then he says this crazy thing that doesn't make so much sense to us. He says, for our light and momentary troubles. How many of your troubles feel light and momentary? We feel like the world's ending, right? When we got trouble, when my whole family's sick today. And, you know, I mean, it's like the Walking Dead around our house. I mean, just we feel like the world is ending and everybody's dying, and every breath at night when they're wheezing and hacking and coughing is going to be their last, you know. Listen, we don't ever think of our troubles, the stuff that we're going through, as light and momentary. But Paul helps us to try to maintain this eternal perspective. Our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but on what is unseen. For what is seen is only temporary, but what is unseen is eternal. We need an eternal perspective. Luke uses the phrase, Jesus uses this phrase that he used right here in Matthew again in Luke chapter 8. He said, no one lights a lamp and hides it in a clay jar or puts it under a bed. It's silly. Defeats the purpose of the light, right? Instead, they put it on a stand so that those who come in can see the light. For there is nothing hidden. Here it goes again. There is nothing hidden that will not be disclosed. There is nothing concealed that will not be known or brought out into the open. See, up until this point, Jesus has kind of been calling for secrecy. Remember his whole, hey, don't tell anybody what I just did for you. Hey, keep it hush-hush. He even said, right now I'm teaching you in parables so that my greater kingdom purposes aren't fully yet revealed. He's speaking in some mysteries. So in the early part of his ministry, he was speaking in some mysteries and people didn't quite get it. Even his disciples didn't quite get it. They're like, we completely missed what you said. What was that all about? What was that story you told? What was the meaning of that? And so Jesus has been kind of consistently calling for secrecy. Hush, keep it hush. Don't tell anybody what I just did for you. Why was he doing this? We talked about this. He was trying to avoid a misunderstanding of who he was, and it still didn't work. They all misunderstood who he was. Some of them thought he was a good man. Some of them thought he was a prophet. Some of them thought he was reincarnated John the Baptist or Elijah. They didn't understand who he was as Messiah, and even those that thought he might be the Messiah had a misunderstanding of what Messiah was supposed to be about. They wanted him to come and establish a political kingdom and return the glory of Israel back to the good golden days of years of Solomon and David, and to throw off the Roman oppressors and establish a political earthly kingdom. And he says, no, my kingdom is not of this world. It's not an earthly kingdom. It's a kingdom of the heart. It's a spiritual kingdom. So he was calling kind of for secrecy to avoid these mobs that were had a different purpose, a completely different idea of why he came and who he was. But now Jesus says, I'm pulling the lid off. I'm pulling the veil back. Jesus is removing the veil of secrecy, and now he commands his disciples to boldly proclaim to all who will listen what he had whispered in their ears. What he had once kind of spoken to them in secret and quiet, alone by them, just for them. He says, now go get up on the housetop. By the way, in Palestine, all the roofs were flat. In fact, they would put like patio furniture up there. Or sometimes they would put, they would dry out some wheat up on top of the roof, or they would put, you know, even put a bedroom up there. Some people sleep up there out under the stars. But all the roofs in Palestine were flat. And they weren't multiple stories, you know, one or two stories. And they would get up on top of the roof, and there wasn't a bunch of noise, like traffic noise and chaos of the city. It was quiet. So you could get up on the roof, and you could speak to somebody down in the street very clearly and have a conversation. And he said, look, we're not doing this behind closed doors anymore. The gloves are off. The veil's pulled away. I want you to stand on the housetops, and I want you to scream from the rooftops the good news of the gospel. Proclaim it boldly, without fear, courageously. Get up and speak to the world what I have whispered to you in secret behind closed doors. And boldly proclaim to all who will listen. So in a sense, this is crazy if you think about it. This is kind of what Jesus meant when he said, greater things than these. They said, wow, you're the greatest. Jesus, you do all these great things. He says, you're going to do greater things than me. We tend to think immediately that he was talking about the miracles that he did. They did do some miracles. But really, in the sense he's talking about their public ministry, the apostles are going to have a far more fruitful and effective public ministry than Jesus himself had. When Jesus left the earth, he had 120 disciples to show for it. After Peter's first message, there were 3,000 that were added to the church. I mean, they had a much more effective ministry, and part of that was because of this principle. He says, what has been spoken, he goes, my goal here was to not only to come to reveal the Father and to declare who I am, but to really train you guys up to turn the world upside down, to train up his disciples, to boldly proclaim to all who will listen. So he told them these things in private, some of which they didn't understand until after the resurrection. And he commanded them to proclaim them fully and publicly. So we're not to, as Jesus says here, we're not to hide the gospel. We're not to hide the light of the gospel under a bushel basket or under our bed. Instead, we're to boldly proclaim it for all to hear. So gospel proclamation, gospel ministry in these last days, this is what we're called to do. We're called to make disciples by gospel proclamation, going out on mission and proclaiming the good news of the gospel. It's like a lamp that shines in the darkness. And the days are getting darker, right? And that the light that shines in the darkness, as Jesus said, this is the verdict. The light of God has come into the world, and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. But the light shines in the darkness to reveal sin, and they run from it because they don't want their sin to be brought to the light. But Jesus said, now I want you to shine the light into the darkness to reveal the sinfulness of people so that they can come to redemption in the Savior and hear the truth about him so that they can come to believe in him and repent and be saved before judgment comes. This is important. They're on the wrong side of judgment right now. And he says, we've got, our mission is to bring them to repentance and faith so they can come into the kingdom of heaven and be removed from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of light and come out of judgment into God's blessing. And that's the goal. That's the goal. That's the job, right? Before final judgment comes. So there's an urgency in our mission and message. But just remember this. If we do this, if we do the very thing that Jesus is asking us to do, if we're doing what the king has commanded his subjects, his obedient subjects to do, if we speak God's truth in the daylight, if we shout it from the rooftops boldly, how do you think it's going to be received by a world that's in love with the darkness? It's not going to be received well. So just, and he's preparing his disciples for that. There's going to be opposition. You're going to be opposed, okay? So then Jesus gives us a second reason not to be afraid in verse 28. Let's go to verse 28. Fear God, not man. He says, don't fear those who can kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell. See, the second reason that Jesus gives for not fearing men is that the worst that they can do doesn't hold the candle to the worst that God can do. The worst that they can do to us does not hold the candle to the worst that God can do. The wicked men may have some power, and Satan certainly has power, great power. What's the worst that men can do to us? What is the worst that somebody can do to you? They can kill you. You go, well, that's pretty bad, right? I know for some people, for many people, death is their worst fear. But what Jesus is saying is there's a fate far worse than physical death, and that's eternal death in the lake of fire. That's way worse. That's infinitely worse. Remember, we've talked about this before, but I just want to be clear here. There's two kinds of death, right? Death, the word death actually means separation, okay? There's physical death, which is separation of the eternal soul from the physical body. And then there's spiritual death, which is separation of the soul, the eternal soul, from God for all of eternity in hell. Okay, there's the first and the second death. The first death is physical, the second death is spiritual. And you hear about this a little bit more in Revelation chapter 20, where John, through the Holy Spirit, says, blessed and holy are those who share in the first resurrection, the resurrection to eternal life, okay? The second death has no power over them. That second death being eternal separation from God forever in hell. Those who are Christ, those who have placed their faith in him and are resurrected to eternal life, the second death has no power over them. And then he says, then I saw the great white throne and him who was seated on it. The earth and the heavens fled from his presence, and there was no place for them. And I saw the dead, small and great, standing before the throne, and the books were opened. And another book was opened, which is the book of life. And the dead were judged according to what they had done, as recorded in the books. And the sea gave up the dead that were in it, and death and hell gave up the dead that were in them. Death and Hades gave up the hell that were gave up the dead that were in them. And each person was judged according to what they had done. And then death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. The lake of fire is the second death, okay? And anyone whose name was not found written in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. Hey, that's serious. That's forever. Second death, eternal separation from God forever in the lake of fire. So there are two deaths and there are two resurrections, okay? Physical death and spiritual death, and then the two resurrections are the resurrection of the just to eternal life and the resurrection of the unjust to eternal death, okay? And they're described in detail there in Revelation. Both eternal destinies will be embodied realities. This is important to remember, okay? Both of those eternal destinies will be embodied realities. So both, that means in both places for all of eternity, we will have a body, a physical body, okay? So by the way, who is the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell? Okay, God is, okay? Who's the one that can just kill the body but can't kill the soul? Man, okay? So why would we be more afraid of men than God? Okay? By the way, when this says, fear him who can destroy both soul and body in hell, he's not talking about being annihilated. Okay, because he keeps saying over and over again, this is an eternal reality. The lake of fire which burns forever and ever. This is an eternal reality where the fire is not quenched. Okay, and so there's both heaven and hell are places of eternal reward or eternal punishment for the whole person, body and soul. Okay, body and soul. That's a seriously sobering reality, right? That should motivate our witness. Only what Jesus is saying here is that only God has the power over the second death. Only God has the power to determine the eternal destiny of your soul. Only God has the keys to death and hell. And Jesus' point isn't to scare his disciples into thinking that if they're not spiritual enough, that if they don't go out on mission enough, if they don't do enough, if they're not good enough, that he's going to send them to hell. No, that's not what he's saying. His point is here that we are to fear the one who can determine the destiny of souls, not the ones who only determine the destinies of bodies. He's making a comparison between men and God. Who should you fear? Who's the more powerful? Who can do more? Who is the more powerful? God is, of course. So the proper response to hostility and persecution is to fear God, not man. That's what he's saying. So remember this, the next time that God gives you an opportunity to speak the truth, to shine the light of the gospel in a dark place, and you're tempted to shrink back. Why? There's repercussions, right? You're tempted to shrink back out of fear of what people will think of you or what people might do to you. I mean, things could happen, right? You might be afraid of losing your job if you speak out boldly. Or you might be ostracized by your family. Or you might have a broken relationship. Somebody might be dead and walk away from you. So instead of speaking up, you back down. You go soft. And in that situation, that scenario, you were more afraid of men than you were of God. Because if you really saw God for who he is in all of his glory and majesty and power and greatness, and you gave him the awe and the reverence and worship and obedience that he deserved, you would boldly and courageously speak up for him, regardless of the consequences, right? You would not be afraid of what anybody could do or say to you. You'd be to have a holy, reverent fear of God and say, my God commanded me to do this, regardless of the consequences, and he said that he'll take responsibility for the consequences of my obedience. So I got to trust him. Again, really, think about this. What is the worst that can happen? What can men do to me? They can kill me. And I'm not trying to trivialize death. And you say, well, I don't want to die. Maybe even worse than that. Maybe they'll imprison me and torture me for a long time and then kill me. And I certainly don't want that. I understand that. I don't really either. I don't have a death wish. But don't forget that if we are like our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, then we're going to be treated like he was treated. And they tortured and killed him. By the way, some of us live with a kind of a skewed view of our lives. We go about our lives and we act as if we are never going to die. None of us is getting out of here alive. You realize that, right? The human death rate is like 100%. Okay, you know, Enoch, okay, Elijah, a couple guys, those were crazy anomalies, but none of us is getting out of here alive, okay? It's appointed unto man wants to die. We're all going to die. Remember what the apostle said? For me to live is Christ and to die is gain. This is the different perspective. This is the eternal perspective of disciples of Jesus, that when we die, it's not like, oh, no, it's all over. No, it's just beginning eternity with my Savior in the new heavens and the new earth with a new glorified body. And don't you know, like all of creation and even you and I are groaning under the curse of sin? Don't you groan every day? You're one of those that rolls out of bed. You don't just bounce out of bed. Maybe you are one of those that bounces out of bed and says, good morning, Lord. Today's your day. Yay, Jesus. Most of us are like, oh, good Lord, it's morning, right? And we're groaning under the curse. We got to go battle again today. Man, I just barely dragged through yesterday. And man, I just don't have the resources and strength and grace and peace and whatever I need for today. Well, you do. Jesus has promised it. That's the encouraging thing, right? And so don't forget that Paul said, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain. And then he said this, I consider, here's that eternal perspective again, I consider that our present sufferings are not even worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us one day. The sufferings of this life don't hold a candle to the brightness of the glory of all of eternity in the presence of our Savior. And hearing him say, well done, well done. Have you heard that of these Olympians? They talk about all the years of hard work and dedication, the pain of the struggle, of the training, of recovering from injuries, of grueling workouts. And they get just this one little moment to stand on the podium, just this one little moment when somebody puts a medal around their neck and all the world applauds. And they said it was all of that pain. It's the idea. Years of pain. Really? Years of pain are worthy. Don't hold a candle to that moment of glory. They said, it's all worth it. How much more when we stand before our Savior, when he stands on the Bema seat and gives us the crown of righteousness, the crown of victory, and he says, well done, good faithful servant. Enter into your rest. Enjoy the glorious spoils of your victory, your faithfulness for overcoming the world. That's going to be a great day. And then all of this, the sufferings and groanings of this present life, will fade into oblivion, will pale in comparison to all of eternity in the presence of God. It's worth it. It's worth it. The Apostle Peter, who was standing there when Jesus spoke these words, he said this, dear friends, don't be surprised at the fiery trial that has come on you to test you as though something strange were happening to you. Jesus said this was going to happen. Jesus said this is what his disciples were going to experience. In this world, you're going to have trouble. If you're going to live godly in Christ Jesus, you will suffer persecution. Why are you surprised that this is happening to you? But rejoice. Instead of moaning and groaning over the hardship of our lives, we rejoice in as much as we get to participate in the sufferings of Christ, so that you may be overjoyed when his glory is revealed. When his glory is revealed is when he comes back and we go to be with him. We're going to be overjoyed. We're going to be rejoicing. So if you're insulted because of the name of Christ, you're blessed. For the Spirit of glory and of God now rests on you. And if you suffer, it shouldn't be as a murderer or a thief or any other kind of criminal or even as a meddler. But if you suffer as a Christian for doing right and for boldly proclaiming the gospel, don't be ashamed. But praise God that you bear his name. For it is time for judgment to begin with God's house. It begins with us. What will the outcome be for those who don't obey the gospel of God? If it's hard for the righteous to be saved, what will become of the ungodly and the sinners? So then, those who suffer according to God's will, did you hear that? Suffer according to God's will. You mean it's God's will that we suffer? Jesus said it. See, if we're doing what we're supposed to be doing, and if we're living how we're supposed to be living, and if we're saying what we're supposed to be saying, we will suffer. So that's suffering according to God's will. Then we should commit ourselves to our faithful Creator and continue to do good. Not shrink back in fear, but continue to do good in bold proclamation. Don't be surprised by suffering and persecution. Instead, rejoice. Why? Because we get to share in Christ's suffering, and we will be blessed and overjoyed to share in his glory one day. It will be worth it. So what does he say? Commit yourselves to our faithful God. Continue to do good. Don't shrink back. Fear God, not man. Don't be afraid of persecution, of what man can do to you. Boldly proclaim the good news of the gospel. And here's the final point. That's what he just said. Trust your Father's care. Trust the faithful God who cares for you. Jesus said, are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You're worth more than many sparrows. Again, this can be a little overwhelming for his disciples, and it's a little overwhelming for you and I as we think about the nature of the task to go out on mission in a dark world of people that hate God and hate his people, and we're going to be persecuted. That isn't super exciting for most of us because we want to be liked, okay? And so his disciples are being sent out as sheep among wolves, and they're going to experience opposition, and that can be overwhelming and scary. And it can be overwhelming and scary for us in the 21st century. So to reassure them of God's fatherly love and care, Jesus contrasts their great worth with the comparatively insignificant value of a sparrow. Sparrows were sold in the marketplace in Jesus' day, two for a penny. Two for a penny. 1/16th of a denarius, which was a day's wage. And it was food for poor people. You think a sparrow, man, you don't get much. You know, like, gonna need more than two, unless you're on a diet. But the point is that they're not very valuable. Two for a penny. You could get five for 2 cents. It was a bargain, you know. Two for a penny or five for two pennies. But if God's sovereign care is so all-encompassing that not even a sparrow that seems ubiquitous and not super valuable to the world, that not even a sparrow can fall to ground outside of God's care, cannot that same God be trusted to extend his love and care over you, his disciples, as you go out on mission for him and proclaim the good news of his kingdom? The answer is, of course, yes. Absolutely, you can count on the Father's care for you. If he cares for sparrows, how much more will he care for you? You're more valuable than they are. Not only that, Jesus tells them that the good news, Jesus tells them that the hairs on their head are numbered, right? The very hairs, some of us doesn't have to count very high, right? But the number of hairs on their heads are all count, on our heads are counted. What is he saying? God's sovereign concern is not limited to only life and death issues, right? So Jesus' third reason for not being afraid is the very opposite of what most people think. Most people believe that God cares only about the big things. He doesn't sweat the small stuff. He isn't interested in the little details. But Jesus assures them that God's control and concern over the tiniest of details should give us confidence in how much more he cares for his own children and will vindicate us through our suffering, in spite of our suffering. And Jesus reminds us that God is our Father, and his love and concern and care for us is as a father loves and cares for his children. So how could we be afraid when the infinitely powerful and infinitely good God of heaven is our Father? I think I've told you this story before, but when I was like in the third grade, I started riding my bike to school, which is like 5 miles away, no big deal. It's kind of cool. I was feeling my independence as a third grader riding my bike to school, right? But I was in the third grade, and I had to drive back on the way home from school past this bus stop where some of the older kids from the junior high were there. And there was a group of eighth grade guys. You know, what is it with eighth grade boys, huh? Huh? What's it with eighth grade boys? There's some bullies standing on the street corner, and they used to hurl, you know, insults at me as I rode my bike by. And one day they thought it'd be great to stop me and harass me a little bit. And so I was riding my bike by, and I always tried to speed up when I went by the bus stop where these guys got off, and they always got off before I could get past, right? So they were standing there, and so I drive by, and they jump out of the bushes, they grab my bike, and they're trying to take my bike, so I'm trying to stay on my bike, and then they start punching me. start punching me and calling me names, and they tell me they're going to do all this stuff to me. And I was like getting a little distressed, a third grader, eighth grader. Right? I was kind of getting a little freaked out. About that moment, my dad comes around the corner driving his pickup truck. And I just held up my hand, and I don't even know that I called. I just said, "That's my dad." And my dad said later that he looked over and saw the look in my eye, and he just like swerved over and like ran into the curb. And these guys, then he jumped out of the car. Have you seen my dad? 6'6", 285, something like that. And their eyes got big. They were like, you should have heard him scream. And they like jumped and they like ran. And my crazy dad took off running after him into this apartment complex. I was like, what were you going to do if you caught him? It's a good thing I didn't. He goes, I didn't really think that through. You were my son. You were in trouble. Something needed to happen. And he came to my rescue. And I've got this earthly father who loves his son and is going to do what he can to protect him and to watch over him and to defend him and to provide for him. How much more, Jesus says, your Father in heaven, who is infinitely more powerful and infinitely more good and infinitely more wise, can't you trust his protection and his provision for you? And of course, the answer is yes. See, as disciples, if we're to faithfully carry out our mission in this world, we need to have a clear perspective that even though this life is short and our mission is going to be opposed, it's going to be opposed, that our Father is with us. He's a present Heavenly Father. He's watching over us. And one day, he promises this, that our faith will be greatly rewarded. And we will enter into eternal life and share in the glory of our risen Savior. And he will ensure that justice is done and that all the wrongs done to us for our faithful witness will be made right. And that knowledge should encourage us as believers in the darkest of circumstances, even in the hardest of our days where we're slogging through and trying to be faithful and trying to carry on the mission of Jesus. And it should also instill terror in the hearts of those who hate God and persecute his children. There's my dad. And justice is going to be done. So in closing, as you increasingly submit to the Lordship of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit's control of your life, you're going to, as you cooperate with him and submit to him, you're going to become more like him. More like Jesus, less like your old sinful self, less like the world. And the more you become less like the world and put off the sinful affections of your heart and the affections of this world and its values and beliefs and practices, and they're going to be driven out of your life and out of your heart by your increasing affection and love for Jesus, King Jesus, and his kingdom priorities and purposes. And as this happens, as you fall in love and look more and more like Jesus and less like the world is going to like you less too. You're going to be growing increasingly out of step with the culture and they with you. You find that the things that you like to do, used to enjoy doing and thought was fun, isn't so fun anymore. And the things that you used to talk about don't captivate your attention like they used to. You start to love what Jesus loves and you start to hate the kinds of things that Jesus hates. And in fact, Jesus says that because you're like him, they're not going to like you. And they're going to hate you and they're going to persecute you. So the question for you and I, as the followers of Jesus who say yes to him, I'm going to be faithful to go out on mission. I'm going to fear God, not man. How am I to respond? We just said it. Fear God, not man. Continue to boldly share the gospel. Don't fearfully hide the light. Don't hide in your closet. Don't be a in the closet Christian. Don't be an undercover Christian, incognito Christian. But courageously shine the light in the dark for all to see. And what Jesus whispers to you in your heart, in your time with him alone, shout from the rooftops. You don't have to be afraid of what people are going to think or how they're going to respond, because your Father in heaven is the Lord of the universe. He's the God of the universe, and he's promised his faithful care and provision and protection and his eternal reward for your bold witness. So go out and be faithful. The sufferings that you're going to experience don't hold a candle to the glory that's going to be revealed. So do not grow weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up, if we do not lose heart. Don't be afraid. Fear not. Stay the course. Be bold and courageous. Fear God, not man. It'll be worth it. Let's pray. Lord, thank you for the encouragement this morning. Because the truth be told, if we're honest with you and we're honest with each other, we're afraid. We're fearful. We live in a fearful time, in a fearful world, and fear is just daily seeking to choke out our faith and to choke out our boldness and our courage and our witness. We're afraid of men. We're afraid of what they might think of us and what they might do to us. And so we're going to need Spirit-empowered boldness, Spirit-empowered courage. We're going to need to be reminded that we can trust in your faithful care and provision and protection for us. We need to be reminded that the fear of God is the beginning of wisdom, and that the fear of man is a snare. And so we need to fear God rather than men. So help us to renew our commitment today to be bold witnesses, to be faithful witnesses, to be faithful ambassadors for you. Be less concerned about what others think and more concerned about what you think. Give us courage. Give us boldness. Help us to be faithful and obedient. And we will trust you. And help us not to grow weary in doing good, because we know that you promised that there will be a harvest of souls and that we'll be rewarded well, faithfully, for our faithful obedience and bold witness here in this life. We look forward to that day. Until then, help us to put our hands to the plow and not look back. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
All right, let's stand up and respond to that message with the song Promises. That he is with us in the times of persecution, and he is there for us. And so, yeah, let's sing this out.
Time again, you have proven you'll do just what you said. Though the storms may come and the winds may blow, I'll remain steadfast and let my heart learn. When you speak a word, it will come to pass. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting, same I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to from age to age. Though the earth may pass away, the word remains the same. History can prove there's nothing you can't do. You're faithful and true. Though storms may come and the winds may blow, remain steadfast and let my heart burn. When you speak a word, it will come. Faithfulness to me.
put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. Sing it again. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. No, he'll never let me down. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise your name. Great is your faithfulness to me. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground. Yeah. My hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. I put my faith in Jesus, my anchor to the ground, my hope and firm foundation. He'll never let me down. No, he'll never let me down. Believe it. Great is your faithfulness to me. Great is your faithfulness to me. From the rising sun to the setting same, I will praise your name. From the rising sun to the